Hi everyone. A lot of you have been submitting YouTube comments, and a lot of you guys have questions on prostate cancer that you would like us to ask Dr. Scholz. And today, we're going to answer those questions. What's the status and reliability of liquid biopsy?
In liquid biopsy, people, I think, sort of initially jump to the thought, oh, I don't have to have a needle biopsy if my PSA is high. And liquid biopsy isn't talking about that. What they're talking about is in the men with very advanced prostate cancer, more and more research is showing that if you biopsy a metastatic lesion, like on a bone or in the liver, and analyze the genetics, it may guide you to a specific therapy that will be effective. And doing biopsies of the liver or the bone is uncomfortable and difficult, a little risky. And so a liquid biopsy, something where you just do a blood test, is obviously very attractive. And these types of blood tests do exist and are available. One's called Guardant 360, another one's called Foundation 1. And they appear to be about as accurate as sticking needles into metastatic lesions. While a liquid biopsy is something that we use routinely in our practice, it's for men that have very advanced treatment-resistant cancers, and we're trying to figure out if there's some available type of treatment that would help them.
Do you think in the future that the liquid biopsies will eliminate the, you know, the actual bone biopsies and everything?
Well, I think they already have, yeah. There are doctors that are still doing the bone biopsies and the liver biopsies, but they are, very cumbersome and uncomfortable. And so we don't really do any more bone or liver biopsies. We only do liquid biopsies.
Our next question is, Dr. Scholz, can you please comment on post-radiation recurrence treatment options?
Well, that's a huge field. In the book I wrote, we call it Indigo, PSA relapse prostate cancer presents in so many different forms. It's very important to look at PSA doubling time to see how serious it is. Some men have very slow progressing cancers, others rapid. And then, of course, the big breakthrough, as we already mentioned, is the advanced scanning now that we have, like Axumin and PSMA PET, to find where the cancer is coming from and possibly treat it or even cure it. So I'd say that those are the two important take-home messages for PSA relapse, but it's a vast field. I mean, you could write a whole book on PSA relapse prostate cancer and the different ways to treat it and who should have treatment, who shouldn't have treatment. But the good news is with prostate cancer, many men get a second chance, sometimes even a third chance to cure the cancer, even if it comes back. And that's very unusual in the cancer world. With most other cancers, if they come back, the situation's pretty hopeless. But with prostate cancer, there's still hope that you might even be able to cure it.
So I know you said it was a huge field, but what if the cancer relapse is exclusive to the prostate?
Yeah, and that used to be a common problem with older types of radiation, and used to make the surgeons tear their hair out because it's difficult to do an operation in a previously radiated prostate. But now, say we have one of these fancy PSMA PET scans and it shows there's nothing outside, that it just came back inside the prostate. There's so many options. I mean, the salvage cryotherapy, laser treatments, high-intensity focused ultrasound, other forms of salvage radiation, salvage seed implants, can be readministered in men that have had previous radiation. We don't see that problem as frequently now because modern radiation is so much more thorough than what was available 15, 20 years ago. But if it does happen, there's lots of good options now that people will have an excellent chance for cure with a second-line therapy.
I'm glad you mentioned that because I think a lot of people don't think you can re-radiate, and so they automatically think if they failed radiation, they have to go straight to surgery. And we see this myth come time and time again. So
it used to be true. 15 years ago, that was the only option, but technology marches on, and we have a lot of different options these days.
How are the toxicity levels if you're going to re-radiate? I know it obviously would vary depending on the type of radiation, but I would imagine that you've already had a certain set of side effects from the first radiation treatment. Would the second radiation treatment be more,
Well, it depends a lot on the skill of the doctor. This is not the kind of thing you'd have done by the corner radiation therapist. You want to go down to an academic center that has a track record doing this. But my experience when, seasoned experts are doing this type of thing is that the toxicity is really it's not a major issue at all. These patients do quite well.
So our next question is quite interesting. Why do you not address the possibility of physical castration instead of all these chemical treatments, especially for a man in his mid-70s? The cost alone would kill him.
Well, most people have insurance. If we're talking about the United States, the cost is almost never an issue. But another consideration is that in this modern era, many men are not getting lifelong hormone treatment. Castration is terrible word, but where they remove the testicles with a surgical operation, or you give men an injection that causes the testicles to stop functioning. The therapeutic effect is equivalent. But the shots are reversible, whereas the men that have surgery, it's irreversible. And there are plenty of studies now showing that even men that have incurable prostate cancer can safely take holidays. It's called intermittent therapy, and allow their testosterone to come back and their quality of life to improve. And it can be done in someone that's had surgical castration. You would actually have to give them testosterone, which a lot of people, not myself, but others are nervous about doing that. So we don't order surgical castration in our patients, but perhaps in a poor country where the cost of injectable therapy is high, that could be a consideration in people that have advanced, irreversible, hormone-sensitive, metastatic cancer. That is a potential place where surgery could be used, I suppose, though we don't use it here in the United States.
So our next question is, Dr. Scholz, can you please explain how and why some men are not suitable candidates for seed implants? And how often, well, there's a couple questions here, so let's start with that.
Well, men that have very, very large prostates, it's more difficult to do seed implants. If there is just a section of the gland that has cancer, one could do a focal seed implant. The irritation of the urinary passage going through the prostate by radiation becomes a bigger problem as the prostate gets larger and the dose of radiation gets larger. So men that have a lot of pre-existing urinary issues may not be good candidates for seed implants either. And then other than that, it would just be, I suppose, people that aren't candidates for local therapy. If cancer is already spread somewhere, treating the prostate may no longer be appropriate, although there's even debates about that. But it's primarily either excess urinary problems or perhaps a very, very large prostate would be potential contraindications to doing a seed implant.
For people who have large prostates, is there things that they can do to get it down so that they would be candidates?
Yes, it depends on how large it is, but prostates can be reduced in size with hormone treatments. Prostate gland will get smaller. And that may also, may be possible to treat men that have these increased urinary symptoms as well with various pharmaceutical agents, and then they could become eligible for seed implants. So it's not common for people to be ineligible for seed implants, but there are certain situations where maybe another treatment would be better.
The same person asked, how and why does calcification occur in the prostate?
Well, calcification is a process that occurs over time in areas of scarring. You can see calcification in the blood vessels, which we call hardening of the arteries, which is an inflammation of the arterial wall. And then after the inflammation settles down, it creates scar tissue. And then the body deposits calcium in those areas of scarring. And same thing happens in the prostate. Low-grade inflammation is extremely common in the prostate. And so you get areas of inflammation, then scarring, and then calcification. It's a benign issue for the most part, and it's extremely common. When we do high-resolution ultrasounds on men over age 50, more than half the men have significant amounts of calcium in their prostate, and it's part of the aging process.
Is it possible for a man to have seed implants where there is calcification?
Certainly, yeah. The calcium itself is a benign phenomena that doesn't preclude treatment. Seed implants can easily be done. I think high-intensity focused ultrasound can be a problem if there's large amounts of calcium, but it's not a contraindication for seed implants.
One of the questions I've seen a couple times is people asking how much water they should drink, or their doctor is telling them to drink water before the radiation treatment. So I don't really think it's about the amount. Why do they have men drink water before radiation?
Well, as most people are aware, the urinary bladder is very close to the prostate, and the prostate isn't like stuck to a bone or anything like that. It can move around. And radiation doctors want to have the prostate in the same exact location every time you go in for your radiation treatment. They want you to have the same amount of bladder expansion or amount of urine in your bladder when you go in for the treatment. So they want to develop consistency so they get greater accuracy with their radiation.
Thank you so much for watching. If you would like Dr. Scholz and I to cover one of your questions, you can go ahead and leave them in the comment section of this YouTube video or on our other videos, and we can go ahead and pick them up from there. Also, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. The subscribe button's right here on the right. We come up with new prostate cancer videos every week, and visit our website, pcri.org, if you would like more information. We hope you have a great week.